First of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to explain some of the work we did here. We did in the past. So I'll talk about one paper, but it's a long one, and it's called Infinite Chiral Symmetry in Four Dimensions. So the main reference that I need to give is just this archive number. And I should probably list my collaborators, Chris Beam, Madalena Lemos, Pedro Liendo, Wolfgar Pilars, who you've seen last week, and Leonardo Rastelli. So before I begin, I would like to also say sorry for a few things in advance. One of them is that there are too many cues, so one cue is not another cue. And if it's not clear from the context which cue I mean sometimes, you should please interrupt me and ask which cue I mean. So also for indices, there are not enough letters in the alphabet, so sometimes I will not be very consistent with the use of indices. I'll try to or at least explain it when I use a specific index what it stands for, but it's not going to be consistent throughout the talks. That's just too complicated. And then finally, a third apology is that at the beginning, I think I would like to discuss quite a bit in quite some detail the representation theory of the superconformal algebra that we'll be considering. And so this means that you will have a solid background, hopefully, if you pay attention in the next 2 hours in the representation theory of this algebra. It comes at the expense of talking about chiral algebras. I think it was a worthwhile trade-off or worthwhile thing to do, because if you understand the representation theory, it'll be much easier to understand both the chiral algebras themselves, but also lots and lots of works on, say, the bootstrap approach to four-dimensional n equals two superconformal field theories. That's like, no matter which paper you open on this subject, they basically assume some familiarity with the representation theory of this algebra. So that's why I think it's good to spend some time on this. So what's the context we'll be working in? I'll be almost entirely looking at four-dimensional n equals two superconformal field theories. These often have conformal manner of, or sorry, moduli spaces, so of vacua. We'll be looking at these theories at their superconformal fixed points, so not going out on the moduli space, either the Coulomb branch or the Higgs branch or whatever branch. In these theories, I will look you have a lot of observables in these theories. I'll be focusing exclusively on correlation functions of local operators. These are, of course, gauge invariant local operators, if your four-dimensional theory happens to be a gauge theories. And last of all, for at least the first hour or two, I'll be taking an operator algebraic viewpoint. So I'll take the correlation function sort of as abstract objects, and of course the algebra that they generate through the operator product expansion as an abstract algebra. And in particular, I will almost never refer to a Lagrangian, at least in the first half of the talk. So the Lagrangian, for now, does not really play a significant role in my talks. This is a bit orthogonal to what you have been seeing in all the other lectures, basically theories where localization applies need some kind of Lagrangian description, some kind of path integral. In this lectures, I'll not need it, at least in the majority of the lectures, I'll not need this description. So if you look at this set of observables in these kind of theories, the first thing you should realize is that these local operators, they transform under the symmetry algebra. So basically, their states, the associated states from representations of the symmetry algebra of four-dimensional n equals 2 superconformal theories. And this algebra is SU2,2/2. So what does this algebra have? Well, as a maximal bosonic subgroup, it has the conformal algebra in four dimensions, or maximal bosonic subalgebra. And then it has an SU2 R symmetry, and then it has a U1 R symmetry. So in contrast to Zohar, I'll be using capital R for the SU2 labels and little r for the U1 labels. I think Zohar has a capital 1 for the U1 and an S, I think, for the SU2. I'm sorry for that. So what is the what does this algebra consist of? Well, first of all, there's the conformal algebra, which I have already I've given a few important elements or a brief summary of the conformal algebra on this board here. So the conformal algebra contains, as a particular subalgebra, the Poincaré algebra, which has, of course, the boost or rotations, the translations, which are generated by this vector field, special conformal transformations, which are special to conformal theories, they're generated by this conformal vector field, and then there's, of course, dilatations, which are generated, which correspond to scalings, i.e., to this conformal vector field. Here, the commutators of the Poincaré, well, most of the commutators are obvious. Here are a few to remind you of the commutators for conformal field theory. The translation operator is just a derivative, so it has weight 1, dilatation weight 1, and the special conformal the generator of special conformal transformations has weight minus 1, and the commutator of a special conformal generator and the translations gives you some rotations which are not very important, and then the dilatation operator. So who has seen this algebra before? Almost everybody, right? Okay, very good. Who knows, before plunging into the representation theory? Yes, who knows what, who can tell me, who is comfortable, who would be comfortable telling me what a conformal primary is? If I would not ask you to actually do it, but would you feel comfortable or not? Conformal primary? Yeah, a few of the organizers.
And you generated the algebra by getting with operators. It's not quite a precise definition.
Okay. It was just an opinion poll to see what you guys know and don't know. That's fine. I can do in some detail the representation theory of the conformal algebra first, and then see how that fits into the representation theory of the superconformal algebra. This was actually part of my plan, so that's totally fine. Before I do the representation theory of the conformal algebra, let me briefly list what extra stuff is there in the superconformal algebra. In the supersymmetric version, you get, of course, a bunch of supercharges which transform in a doublet of SU2. So here, this capital I index is the SU2 index, and they have U1 charge a half, and the alpha here is, of course, spinner index. There are Q tildes with opposite U1R charge and the opposite spinorial representation. And then there are special conformal, what we call conformal supercharges, S and S tilde. And then, of course, there's the SU2R symmetry, which is this guy, these three generators. And there's a little U1R. There are a few extra commutators I can write down here. So obviously, Q tilde, QQ tilde gives you the translations as usual. So just as the supercharges are like the square root of translations in this precise sense, the special conformal supercharges are, are the square root in the precise sense of the special conformal transformations. And the Qs with themselves commute to zero, the Ss with themselves anti-commute to zero, same for the Q tildes and the S tildes. maybe one more thing that I can write down. So So QS bit themselves. This is a bit of a nasty anti-commutator. One half delta ij, delta alpha beta, d plus, well, delta ij, m alpha beta, minus delta alpha beta, r ij. Where this r ij is an object that I wrote down here because I'm going to need it later. So r ij is defined as follows. R11, R12, R21, R22 is the same as the matrix R over 2 plus R, R plus, R minus, and R over 2 minus R. Just so you know. Okay, so that's the superconformal algebra. Keep that in mind for later. So all of this is actually, and in this paper. So this algebra, if you want to see it in its full glory, please go to appendix, I believe appendix A of that paper, and you'll find it there. I should have probably mentioned this before you had to scribble this down hastily. Sorry for that. So representation theory. let me, as a brief interlude, so intermezzo, open parentheses, we'll close them in about 10-15 minutes. The representation theory, well, not the full representation theory, we'll discuss some representation of the conformal algebra, namely those that are useful in physics. There are other representations that are not used in physics because, for example, they could be unitary, but they would have unbounded energy. Energy unbounded from below. So those, for physical reasons, other representations are excluded. So before I start discussing the representations, let me say that in radio quantization, I work in radio quantization, where you take your time to be sort of the radio coordinate. And then there exists, then your Hilbert space of states is a Hilbert space defined on a spatial sphere, a D minus one sphere. And for this Hilbert space, there exists a state operator correspondence. And actually, all that we'll be needing is very little. It just says that for us, it'll mean that for every operator, I can define a state which is just generated by inserting this operator at the origin and acting on the vacuum. So here, I want to add that this is an element of the Hilbert space on a tree sphere and not some flat space Hilbert space. And this omega symbol here is the vacuum. It's the unique state that I assume it's unique and it's killed by all the generators in your conformal algebra. Actually, since we're in the intermezzo, I shouldn't talk about the superconformal algebra, but I can already tell you that this vacuum is also killed by all the generators of the superconformal algebra, that are not in the conformal algebra. So this Hilbert space is your vector space that's going to furnish representations of the conformal algebra. So what does a representation look like? Well, every representation begins with a certain operator that we're going to call a primary operator, which has the special feature that, well, first of all, it's an eigenstate of dilatations. Sorry, this is incorrect. At zero. So now let me do this a bit more precisely. I'll just do this. So the corresponding state is an eigenstate of dilatations. And the corresponding state is also killed by all the conformal supercharges. So remember that the conformal, special conformal generator. Remember that the special conformal generator has weight minus one. So in this sense, this is a lowest weight state in your representation, because if I try to lower the weight, I get zero. And so how do I generate higher weights? Well, that's easy. The translations have weight plus one. So I'll just act on this guy with the translation operator. So let me take the state and act on it with p mu. Well, the state that I get then is just the derivative of the guy. And of course, I can go on. So I can act with another p mu and so on. And this generates my infinite dimensional representation of the conformal algebra. And if this is a primary, then these guys are called descendants. So notice that, so here I have the operator at the origin and derivatives of the operator at the origin. I'd like to sometimes think of the operator OI of x inserted not at the origin for at some other point x as just generated from the operator at the origin by exponentiated translations. Sometimes I want to do that, which is of course fine. And if I take OI of x and I act on the vacuum and I let it act on the vacuum, then of course this thing here on the right hand side disappears because the vacuum is killed by p mu. But this means in particular that since the special conformal generator does not commute with translations, it means that k mu does not commute, does not give zero. k mu does not commute with this operator inserted at x unless x equals zero and OI is primary. So these, if we now go back to these equations, there's a zero here, there's a zero here, there's a zero here. These are zeros are very important. The moment you start translating this operator, this first and this second equation no longer hold. So I just wanted to stress that. And this is actually the only comment I wanted to make here. So this is, in a nutshell, very simple. The representation, these are the essentials of the representations of the conformal algebra. Let me do an example very briefly. So we'll do a free massless boson, let's say in four dimensions, phi of x. So it satisfies the Klein-Gordon equation, box phi of x equals zero. So in this theory, you can easily show that if you just take the Lagrangian and you see how it is conformally invariant and how the special conformal guys and the dilatations and all of them act on the field, fields, you'll find that phi of x is a primary. So I say here phi of x is a primary, it means that just in that sense, right? So I take phi of x, I put it at the origin, and the state that I generate in that way has these properties. Even though there's an x here, I still call it a primary. Phi to the n of x for any n is actually also any positive n, normal ordered if you want, is also a primary. I can define another primary like t mu nu, which is d mu, d nu, d mu phi, d nu phi, and then some other stuff, eta mu nu, d rho phi, d rho phi, plus 2 over d minus 1, phi, d mu, d nu phi. So this, as it happens, is also, so it takes a lot of work here if you want to check this. But it is actually a primary. Notice there are a lot of translation operators. So you take this guy, you insert it at the origin, you act with k, you have to sort of you have to commute this k with all the translations, you generate all this junk here, you do some rotations and so on, but in the end you'll find that this is a primary. And there are many, many other primaries in this theory, but these are just some simple ones. And descendants, well, it's easy to generate a descendant, because if a phi of x is a primary, then the derivative of phi is a descendant. And similarly, it would be the case that, so sometimes it's not entirely obvious that an operator is a descendant. So let me, can I lower this all the way down? Great. So sometimes it's not entirely obvious. A somewhat too trivial example is, for example, phi d mu phi. This is, of course, the same as 1/2 d mu phi squared. And now you see that this is also a descendant. And if you're given a general sort of bunch of phis and bunch of derivatives, some contracted, some not, it's not so easy to see whether it's a primary or a descendant. Or maybe it could be a combination of those, and then you sort of have to see how everything fits in a big representation of the conformal algebra to see what kind of combination of primaries and descendant a given operator is made out of. One very important reason that I wanted to talk about this representation is that sometimes something funny happens. So for example, I told you that phi is a primary. So OK, let me act with derivatives and generate descendant. Let me, in particular, act with two derivatives and contract them. So I act with the Laplacian. Then I don't get a new state. I get 0. Laplacian on phi is 0. So this is actually a more general phenomenon. Sometimes a descendant is null. So it has 0 norm. I haven't really talked about norms, and I don't want to. But believe me that sometimes there is a good notion of norm here. There's a proper Hilbert space, and in that norm, you just find that the Laplacian acton on phi is 0 norm. It's null, and therefore decouples. So this happens, and you just ignore it. You basically cross it out from the list of operators. And then you can say that the representation is said to be short. Of course, descendants of a null are also null, so you just remove the entire conformal representation generated by the null states.
So you think that the representation is not necessarily the same as the Verma module?
That's correct. If you know what a Verma module is, that's exactly correct. But if you know what a Verma module is, then you should. Then this is not so hard. So if I continue this example, example continued, box phi is 0, so this is a null descendant of the primary phi, and this operator t mu nu that I defined also has a null descendant. If I take one derivative and contract the indices, I also get 0. And this, of course, makes you realize that this t mu nu that I defined is nothing but the stress tensor in the theory. So the stress tensor in a conformal field theory sits in a short representation of the conformal algebra. It's a primary, and it sits in a, it has a null descendant. And similarly, this is not really my example, so maybe I should write it here. If I have a current j mu, it also has a null descendant. So currents also automatically sit in short representations of the conformal algebra. Yes?
When you say that the stress tensor is a primary, are you assuming that d greater than 2?
Yes. In d equals 2, my algebra is infinitely bigger than the one I wrote there. I can still define this subalgebra. In d equals 2, it would be SL2R cross SL2R. And with respect to this subalgebra, the stress tensor is actually a primary. I believe these are then called quasi-primaries.
So is the stress tensor always a primary?
Well, that was a question. Oh, yes, sorry. The question now is whether the stress tensor is always a primary. In d greater than 2, that's always the case. And since I'm in this context of 4D n equals 2 theories, let's say yes. In this context, it's absolutely always a primary. That's a good question. Yeah, it depends a bit on what your axioms are, I think. If you want to say that this guy generates the conformal transformations by integrating it, so this P is not just a random P and that T is not a random T, then, but you say, well, that P is just the integral of the stress tensor, and similarly for everything else, then I think it's easy to show that the stress tensor is a primary. Because that was the question, how do you show that the stress tensor is always a primary? Alternatively, I think you can just go over the list of representations and find that, then it's absolutely clear that this is that it has to be a primary, right? Because if the stress tensor would be a descendant, it would be the derivative of something, and if I would integrate it, then I would not get something meaningful. More generally, I think you can just go over the representations and see which ones are allowed, and you'll find only one sort of feasible stress tensor representation, which is this one. Also, these null states and null descendants, they generate constraints. You, for example, see that this can only happen if the dimension of phi in general dimensions is d minus 2 over 2. And this will also tell you that the dimension of T mu nu is actually equal to D, and this will also tell you that the dimension of J mu is equal to D minus 1. So I wasn't planning to go into the details of that. You can just show this using the fact that you want this to have zero norm, but that to explain it requires me to explain the concept of norm, and I don't really want to do that. Okay, any questions about the representation theory of the conformal algebra? No? Good, then I can close my parentheses. and the intermezzo ends, and we can start talking about superconformal algebra. So for the superconformal algebra, the representation theory is fairly similar, at least when it comes to the physically relevant representations, in the sense that they're always generated by one special operator. So we say the representation theory of SU2,2/2, or any superconformal algebra for that matter. So there is one special guy. I denoted as u hat I for now, where this is some multi-index. So it captures all the quantum numbers for now of the superconformal algebra. So let's see what the quantum numbers are. Well, there's a scaling dimension for the operator delta. There are Lorentz spins, J1 and J2. And then there's an SU2R symmetry and a U1R symmetry. So those are all the quantum numbers that you need to generate to describe a representation. And this special guy is called the superconformal primary. And in particular, it's a conformal primary. So if I insert it at the origin, then it is an eigenfunction of dilatations. It is killed by all the special conformal generators as before. And it is now also killed by all the S's. So S and S tilde for any value of their indices also kills the operator. This operator could be a fermion, so let me write it like this. And then how do I generate descendants of this guy? Well, I can, of course, act with P mu as before. But I'm not going to write that. So that is one way to generate the descendants. And then, but now I can also act with the supercharges. So I have the Q tilde and the Q's. And they give me some new operator. So let me now do this in the vector space language. So I'll generate a state, and I act, and I get some new x, j on zero on the vacuum, or some y, k. And these, in turn, are conformal primaries. They're not super conformal primaries, but they're conformal primaries. So I can act again with the p mu's on them to generate a tower. And I can also continue to act with the q's or with the q tildes. And I generate some z and some other stuff. And this again gives me a conformal primary, and I act with the p's. So this is what the representation, roughly speaking, looks like for the superconformal algebra. You have a superconformal primary, a bunch of conformal primaries that you can find by acting with the supercharges. And on each of those, there sits a full tower of conformal descendants. And just as the case, the special conformal generators here, I didn't say that in my parentheses. So basically what happens here is that if you act on the k, with the k on the first descendant, well, k commutator p gives you the dilatation operator. So it can eat up the p, and basically up to dilatations and some rotations. It basically moves you back up in the tower. So the p's move you down, and the k's, roughly speaking, move you up. And in the same sense, the q's here move you down. And the S's, they can eat a Q and spit out the dilatation operator and some rotation and R symmetry stuff. But essentially, they move you back up in the chains. So the S tilde move you back this way, and the S's move you back that way. All of this, I should add now, is very schematic. This is not quite correct, what I wrote here. For example, this Z. If you act with a qi alpha and a qi tilde alpha and a qj alpha dot, and you set I equal to j, or you contract the ij indices, then you basically act with the vector operator, and this z will have the same quantum numbers as the superconformal primary, except that its dimension is, well, sorry, it's the same R symmetry quantum numbers as the conformal primary. And so this z can mix with the first descendant, the first conformal descendant of P, of the superconformal primary. In other words, if you act with a P or with two Q's, you can sometimes get an operator with exactly the same quantum numbers, and then generally they mix a little bit. And so you have a bunch of operators here with the same quantum numbers, and you sort of have to undo the mixing a bit and re-orthogonalize your basis to isolate here the conformal primary. So it's not quite true that if I just blindly act with q's and q tildes, I get always conformal primaries. I sometimes need to subtract some descendants of the guys higher up. So that's just a little warning if you actually want to do this stuff. So this is what happens generically. And so a general representation, let me do some important representations. A general representation is denoted with this A in some notation. And then, of course, all the quantum numbers, so RR, J1, J2. And it looks like this. It's basically a full house. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So I have 4 Q tildes, right, because both I and alpha dot range over 4/2 values. So I can go 4 steps this way. I can go 4 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 steps that way. And then, of course, I can complete the thing. So this is basically what this kind of structure looks like for a generic long representation. And this notation here, I should add, comes from a paper by Dolan and Osborne. Also, a paper by Kinney, Maldasenim, and Mala and Raju has considered the representation theory. And there's a new paper in town, and in their language, this thing would be called L bar, J1, J2, delta, R. Let me just highlight this paper here. So it's a paper by Clay Cordova, Thomas Dumitrescu, Ken Intrilligator. And these guys did the great job of classifying not just the representation of our algebra as U2,2/2, but of any superconformal algebra in any space-time dimension. So this is now sort of the standard work to go to if you have questions about the representation theory of superconformal algebras. And they use this notation. Unfortunately, this paper came out fairly recently, and I'm fairly old, so I use the old Dolan and Osborne notation, which maybe we should sort of retire and we should move to this more modern notation. So this is a long multiplet, but of course, interesting operators often sit in short multiplets, just like interesting operators like the stress tensor in a conformal theory sit in a short representation just of the conformal algebra. So you can, for example, ask, well, where does the stress tensor sit in a superconformal theory? It must sit in some representation of the superconformal algebra. And in fact, where it sits is in a multiplet that is commonly written as C hat 0, 0, or AL bar. 0, 0, 0, 0. And this is a multiplet that looks like follows. It's short, so I don't have to write a gigantic diamond like this. There's a superconformal primary. Let me call it T. It has delta equals 2, J1, J2, 0. So it's just a scalar. And it's also a complete R-symmetry singlet. However, it's killed by some supercharges, and therefore I can go only two steps down in the Q tilde direction and Q steps down in the Q direction. It's not terribly important to know the operators at the dots, so let me just ignore them. If I go one step down, it's a commutator I did not write down, but the Qs have dilatation weight 1/2, so that and the Q tildes also, so that the momentum can still have dilatation weight 1. So if this is delta equals 2, then this is delta equals 5/2 fermions. And this is delta equals 3. And if I act with both a Q and a Q tilde, I get something that can have vector indices, J alpha alpha dot. And it's dimension 3. And already when we discussed the conformal algebra, we realized that this was a conserved current. So this guy has a null descendant, and it's a conserved current. In fact, there's another conserved current. So there's one that's an R-symmetry singlet, SU2 R-symmetry singlet, and there's one that's an SU2 R-symmetry doublet. And these are nothing but the SU2 R currents. So these are, I can write it here, SU2 R cross, well, U1 R cross SU2 and SU2 R currents. So the R-symmetry currents sit in the same superconformal multiplet as the stress tensor. So I haven't yet gotten to the stress tensor because it sits even further down. So the multiplet looks like this. So the stress tensor is the lowest component in this ordering of this multiplet, and it has delta equals 4. And it's, of course, conserved. So it's in its own short representation of the conformal algebra. So this is what the stress tensor multiplet looks like. Does anybody know what sits here? Sorry? Supercurrents, right? Yes. So the currents for the Uh, for the supersymmetry transformations, for the Q and Q tilde supersymmetry transformations. So these have delta equals 7/2. So this is what your stress tensor multiplet looks like. And so it's important for later to realize that the R symmetry currents sit in the same multiplet as the stress tensor. Maybe for, I want to discuss briefly one more set of multiplets. So that would be set number 3, which are so-called B-hat R multiplets, or in the newer notation, B-hat B1, B-bar 1, 0, 0, R 0. So these are also short. These are the multiplets, the Higgs branch multiplets that Zohar talked about, I believe, yesterday. So they are superconformal primary is killed by Q alpha 1 and Q tilde alpha 2. The multiplet in general looks like this. So you only have two supercharges to act on, so it's a bit like to act with. So it's something very short. And it's labeled by just the R quantum number, the SU2R quantum number. So what else do I need to say? I need to say the scaling dimension is given in terms of this thing, this SU2R quantum number by, it's 2 times R. And J1 equals J2 equals R has to be 0 for an operator to be the superconformal primary of this multiplet. So notice here that I sort of label a multiplet by the quantum numbers of the superconformal primary. This was implicit, but I hope it's clear. And maybe it's interesting to look at the first two examples. So when R is 1/2, then I have one complex boson with delta equals 1. And it's a complete scalar. It's an U1 R symmetry singlet, and it's a fundamental of the SU2 R symmetry. And then I act with the Q tilde, and in fact, I can only generate these guys. And as it happens, for R equals 1/2, this multiplet is even shorter than this one. It's ultra short, and there's no more non-null descendants. So does anybody know what this multiplet is? Sorry? Free hyper? Hyper multiplet? I wanted to make contact with more Lagrangian notions. So this is just the hyper multiplet, a free hyper multiplet, basically. So this is a dimension 1 complex scalar, and this is a dimension 3/2 fermion, Val fermion, and Val tilde fermion. So in particular, since it is dimension 1, you'll find that box QI is 0. And these guys obey the Dirac equation. So if your theory, if you have a free hypermultiplet theory, a theory of free hypermultiplets, you can alternatively say that this is just that your superconformal theory has a B-hat 1/2 representation. And there's one more that I need to discuss. It'll be useful later. Which is the B-hat 1 multiplet, or B-bar 0, 0, 1, 0, which begins with a delta equals 2 R symmetry triplet guy, generally denoted mu. Then there are two operators that are not so important. And then there's a dimension 3 vector operator, j alpha alpha dot. So this, again, is a conserved current. So it's, again, a short representation of the conformal algebra. And therefore, if your theory has such multiplets, it automatically has conserved currents. These are not the SU2 and U1 R symmetry currents. Those sit in this multiplet. But as it happens, any other current that is not part of some higher spin symmetry has to sit in these multiplets. You can go over the list of all the representations of the superconformal algebra, and you'll find that there's no good candidate for a flavor symmetry current in an interacting theory except this B hat 1 multiplet, which is why it's so important. And in fact, maybe we should dress this guy up, because of course if it has a flavor symmetry and it's non-abelian, then this transforms, this current transforms in the adjoint of any non-abelian flavor symmetry that the theory may have. But the flavor symmetry, by definition, has to commute with the superconformal algebra. So in fact, the entire multiplet then must transform in the same representation of the flavor symmetry. So all of them sit in the adjoint of the flavor symmetry. Finally, let me say in words that there is one more representation that is very well known, which is so-called epsilon multiplets. These are the ones that Zohar talks about. These are the ones that are completely chiral. So they're, for example, killed by all the Q tilde supercharges, or they're killed by all the Q supercharges. So in my picture, they look like a single line, because you can either go only to the right or only to the left. So these are the ones that are important for the Coulomb branch chiral ring. OK, that was the representation theory of the superconformal algebra, to the extent that I thought it would be useful for you guys in general and for what is to come. Do people have questions about this?
Where do the Higgs branch operators
be? That's an excellent question. Here. The Higgs branch chiral ring operators are in B hat multiplets. They're the superconformal primary of B hat multiplets. So this, if your theory has hypers, is a Q. This is the scalar in your free hyper. That's the guy that gets a VEV in a free theory. if you have an SUN gauge theory with NF flavors, I think I had it somewhere written down carefully, but I think I don't have it anymore. Ah, I do have it. So in a if you have NF hypers, for the Lagrangian people in the audience, which is all of you, perhaps, in a representation R of a gauge algebra, let me write it like funny G. So suppose you have this kind of theory, then I can build a B hat 1 multiplet, like so, mu A ij is nothing but q tilde I q j. Now I need some extra. So I need some gauge indices, m bar n. So these are gauge delta m bar n. So I contract it and make it gauge invariant. And then, of course, they also have flavor symmetry. So where these are flavor. And then I can make it the adjoint of whatever flavor symmetry. So this is the adjoint. So this is how I built, and then I normal order this. This is how I built my a B hat 1 representation. It's just a normal order product of two Qs in the hypermultiplet. Oh, so I should I'm now. Yeah, okay. Maybe I should add one more thing. Where's my? So what we have here is an SU2R doublet, but I think Wolfgar already mentioned this because I looked at his notes a bit. So this QI is a doublet, and it's a doublet of complex scalars. So it looks like this. In terms of the usual Q and Q tilde, it's Q, Q tilde star. But then Q tilde J, which I define to be epsilon ij Q star J, J, by the pseudo-reality of the fundamental of SU2 is, of course, is again a b-hat 1/2, and it is q tilde minus q star. So when I write this q tilde j, or q tilde I, and this q j here, I have that in mind. So this very precisely defines how you generate this b-hat 1. And of course, you can sort of normal order them further, and that's an easy operation because it's all part of one chiral ring, and then you generate all the other b-hat representations, or all the, well, not all of them, but you generate other b-hat representations. So any more questions? Okay. Good. Then there's lots of time left to talk about chiral algebras. Right. So, sorry. This one? Ah, sorry. Yes, I wrote here something down and then I missed it. So, there's qi and q tilde j. I just introduced that notation. I won't be needing it much, but I introduced it just to explain that here. So I hope you have a bit of an idea that if you write down I guess the message that I want to convey here is that if you write down an operator, or if you look at the list of operators in an n equals 2 superconformal field theory, every operator comes with a lot of friends in its representation. In particular, all the operators come in these sort of nice structures where you have superconformal primaries and descendants, and then conformal descendants of those. And if you think about now about the stress tensor, say, in a 4D n equals 2 theory, you hopefully realize now that the stress tensor is not isolated, and the stress tensor sits in the same supermultiplet as, for example, the SU2R symmetry curves. So this, for example, implies all kinds of relations, not exactly identity, but connections between, for example, correlation functions of the SU2R symmetry currents and correlation functions of the stress tensor. And similarly, in fact, for this b-hat 1, it's beautiful because, we did some analysis of the four-point function of b-hat 1 multiplets. And this would, in principle, involve a four-point function of currents. And that's just from the conformal field theory perspective, even without supersymmetry, a four-point function of currents is a nasty thing to investigate. But by supersymmetry, this thing was just completely determined in terms of the four-point functions of the superconformal primary of this multiplet, so which happen to be scalars in this case. And so we could investigate the four-point function of scalars and then draw conclusions by virtue of supersymmetry about the four-point function of currents. So that's one of the nice aspects of these sort of relatively big representations that superconformal algebras have. Okay, chiral algebras. Let's begin with the pedestrian approach. So chiral algebras arise in four-dimensional n equals 2 superconformal field theories when you restrict yourself to the cohomology of a certain funny supercharge that I'll introduce later. So all of the structure that I'll outline now will have some cohomological interpretation. But I think it's useful for pedagogical purposes to just give you the results without referring to supersymmetry. And then afterwards, so then it'll be sort of a claim that I cannot prove, that whose proof is not obvious. And then maybe in the second half of this lecture, I can give you the proof of the statements. So now if you ask yourself in the course of this explanation why everything I say is true, please hold that question because I'll be answering that later. So the pedestrian approach is relatively easy. We're going to consider an endpoint function of local operators. And we're going to dress it up in some ways. So I'll write it here. But if you copy these notes, please leave plenty. If you copy this on your notes, please leave plenty of space. So I'll write one operator, another operator. But this could be an endpoint function, another operator. So let's look at an endpoint function in the theory. And let me now do the following things. So I'll first of all restrict myself to a class of operators that I'll call sure operators. These are operators that obey, by definition, the following relation between their quantum numbers. Their scaling dimension is given by the sum of J1 plus J2, so these are the two spins, plus 2 times the SU2R symmetry charge. So these operators will all have to be sure operators. Before I proceed with explaining what kind of correlation function we're going to look at, let me give you a few properties of the sure operators. They are always short. Let me say that they're always in short representations. They're in short irreducible representations of the superconformal algebra. So for example, let's look at this B hat 1. This B hat 1, this mu guy, has delta equals 2, R equals 1, because it's a triplet. And it's a scalar, J1 and J2 equals 0. So if you plug it in, and if I made no mistake, this guy is a sure operator. Similarly, if you go to the stress tensor multiplet, you find that there is a sure operator here. And I leave it up to you to check. Let me add this. So this is sure. In some sense, I'll make this precise, a little bit more precise in a second. And this guy is in some sense also sure. So it has J1 equals a half, J2 equals a half, and R symmetry triplet. So that's a 2 here, at, or 2 times 1. So this is 3, and delta is also equal. So these sure operators, they sit in various places in short multiplets of the superconformal algebra. They're not always superconformal primaries. And as it happens, the actual sure operator is always in a highest weight of SU2R cross SU2 left cross SU2 Lorentz left, Lorentz right. So technically, what I mean is that the sure operator is always the R symmetry indices are always sort of the top ones, so it's 1, 1, 1, 1. Similarly, for the Lorentz indices, they are always in sort of the top ones plus, and the other Lorentz indices are also always plus dot. So this is technically, so when I say that this guy is sure, I actually mean sort of the top components with all the indices pointing in this direction. They also let me squeeze it in here. Sorry for those taking notes. They also always have non-zero SU2R symmetry charge. That's not obvious from what I said so far, but it happens to be true. They always have non-zero R symmetry charge. So in particular, this is one or more indices, because those are the SU2 indices, and these are the Lorentz. So these are zero or more indices. And in fact, we'll need the entire R-symmetry multiplet. So we'll start playing with these top indices, the R-symmetry indices, but we will keep the bottom indices fixed. So I'll not be writing those. So let me write that down. The entire R-symmetry multiplet of the Schur operator I1 I2 I2R plus dot So that these are the kind of operators we're going to consider. So when I now I can dress up this correlation function. So I can say, well, let this guy have spin one, this one be some bispinner, and this one, I don't know, be a scalar, say. So these operators are, these guys are always fixed, and then the R symmetry indices. So let this guy be a fundamental, this guy also fundamental, and this guy be, a triplet, right? Oh, sorry. Yeah, you see, so now I'm mixing up my indices. Up until now, these capital I and J were always SU2R symmetry indices. So I think I can save myself. Let's make these capital. And then these also need to capitalize. I1, I2, I2. So that's better. So these are the operators I'm going to consider. I just by hand decide that I'm only going to consider these kind of operators. I will further consider these operators not inserted at arbitrary space-time points, but instead I'll consider the correlation function where all these operators are restricted to the two-plane, and here I work in Euclidean signature. X1 equals X2 equals 0. And then we have X3 and X4 left, and we'll set Z equals X3 plus IX4 as usual, and Z bar equals X3 minus IX4. So then it is the case that I can denote the positions of these Z1, Z bar 1, Z 2, Z bar 2. I can denote the positions of these operators with just Z and Z bar. And then the next thing I'm going to do is I have this R symmetry indices floating around, and I'll do something peculiar to them. I'll contract them. With a strange thing, so I'll write it out explicitly, a position-dependent vector ui of z bar 1 z bar. So that's what I'll do. I'll take this ui of z bar 1. I need more space. I need more space on either side. Ui of z bar 1, uk of z bar 2. And then I don't have space, so I'll add the other ones here. Ul of z bar n, um of z bar. Right? This is the thing I can do. This is weird. If you don't think this is weird, then you should look again. Right, because I'm here, I have an SU2R symmetry index, and I'm doing something position dependent to these indices. right? The direction in our symmetry space in which this thing is pointing depends on where I insert the operator. This is strange. But it's also very nice because my claim is now that this correlation function is actually meromorphic. In other words, the z bar dependence completely drops out. So if I take any z bar derivative from 1 to n of this object, then I basically get 0. Of course, I get 0 up to contact points. The z bar derivative of 1 over z is a delta function, all of that stuff. But if these guys are not inserted at coincident points, then this is a proper 0. Yes?
Is the bar on the UI a mistake?
The bar on UI is a mistake, yes. Thank you. So the z-bar dependence of this thing just completely drops out. There's no more z-bar dependence in this thing. So that's my claim. And this is nice, because now I have a function that is just meromorphic in all of the other coordinates. And a meromorphic function, I can specify by just completely specifying its position, its singularities, and the location and severity of the singularities. For example, we have a single variable z, and you know that this function has a simple pole at z equals 1, a double pole with given residue, a double pole at some other point, and then a triple pole somewhere else, and you specify all the residues, and then you also know that it falls off at infinity, then you've completely specified the correlation function. The function in that case. And in the same way, these correlation functions, the chiral correlation functions, are completely specified by just giving you the short distance singularities of all these, all the short distance singularities, so all the different ways in which I can put two operators together. And if I just give you the short distance singularities, I know the full correlation function. So you see where. You see, hopefully, this is already gives you a hint of sort of the power of this structure, where all now I need to do is sort of look at the short distance singularities of this correlation function, which often I know something about because I can use the operator product expansion. And I just need a few terms in this operator product expansion here and for all the other short distance singularities. And then, in principle, if you just give me a few terms, I can decide what the entire sort of twisted correlation function is, so this contracted correlation function is. Of course, in general, if you would not do this kind of twist, you wouldn't have the meromorphicity. If I just give you the short distance singularity of a general function, it's in no way clear, in no sense clear, that I can determine the entire correlation function. So it's really meromorphicity that helps you deciding the correlation function in extracting sort of what happens far away from contact points just from the short distance singularities.
You can recover it also in the other two directions?
Which other two directions?
I mean, we restrict it to the plane, right?
Yeah, we restrict it to the plane. We have to do that. I'll show you why later. So the other two directions, things break down. There's actually a good general comment. So your question was, what about the other two directions, like the x1 and x2 directions? Because of this cohomological argument that I'm about to present, the moment you try to move one of these points outside of the plane, all the other points, it will no longer be meromorphic, not in just that position, but it won't be meromorphic in any of the other positions, because you're sort of outside the cohomology. So you destroy the sureness, say, of this operator, you've destroyed everything. Yes.
You claim that this correlation is meromorphic, so why there is no contact term on the right hand side of your to the senior.
Yeah, I said that in words, sorry. So the question is why there's no contact term. I wrote it's equal to zero on the right hand side, but yeah, that's just my laziness. So, okay. I'll fix it because there was a question. So, zero. It's just contact terms. But this, I mean, this is just in the same way that dz bar of 1 over z is a delta function up to some prefactors. Right, so if I have a 1 over z singularity here and I act with the z bar derivative, I get some delta function. So those are the contact terms you get here on the right hand side. So to make this abstract thing a little bit more concrete, let me consider a example, but I'll consider a trivial example for now because it's the easiest. But I hope it's instructive enough to see what's going on. So in the free hypermultiplet theory, which is a b hat 1/2 representation, I have two Schur operators to begin with, which are q and q tilde, which have scaling dimension 1, r equals 1/2, and r equals j1 equals j2 equals 0. So you can check that this guy is Schur. So let's see how this mirror morphicity comes about then, right? And the very simplest correlation function I can consider is, of course, the two-point function of this guy. Let me already insert this on the plane. So I'll take qi of zz bar, qj of ww bar. This is 1 over z minus w squared. And I have to contract these R symmetry indices. So this is epsilon ij. So I know it is two-point function because it's just a free theory, right? This is the Fourier transform of 1 over k squared. Back to and that's, of course, the propagator that you know for a free massless particle. So the Fourier transform is basically 1 over x squared up to some normalization. And I pick my normalization such that this is true. Oh, actually, this is not. It's qq tilde. So if you see how I defined the q and the q tilde before, you'll find that this is the correct two-point function. So how can this guy be meromorphic? Well, it's not so hard. I'll contract like so. I'll take ui of z bar, uj of w bar on both sides, ui z bar, uj w bar. The epsilon ij will give me u1 times u2. U1 of z bar and u2 of w bar, so that gives me w bar, and the other one gives me a z bar. So this is basically w bar minus z bar over z minus w squared. And this is minus 1 over z minus w. So it's chiral, right? The z bar dependence and the w bar dependence has completely dropped out. So this is the very simplest example of this kind of chirality appearing. So the free hypermultiplet has other Schur operators. for example, I can take Q's, I can take a normal ordered product involving any of the following elements. I can take Q's, I can take Q tildes, I can take holomorphic derivatives and say more Q's and more Q tildes and more holomorphic derivative and so on. And all of these, give an insertion point. And all of these operators are, as it happens, also Schur. You see, if I normal order two sure operators, I just add their quantum numbers in this case. So so I get another sure operator. And the holomorphic derivative has J1 equals a half, J2 equals a half, and delta equals 1. So it also is allowed. Taking a holomorphic derivative transforms a sure operator into a sure operator. So this is the same as dz actually in the coordinate system in the conventions that I'm using. So you can.
Do you define normal ordering by subtracting propagators?
In this case, it doesn't matter, but yes. In the free hyper, let's say yes. We will discuss normal ordering in the Chiral algebra sense later on in the lectures. But for now, normal ordering can just be subtracting the singular bits.
Here, normal ordering was defined for the four-dimensional theory.
Yeah, four-dimensional. But it's a free theory. Sorry, was there another question?
So, where are they called?
They are called sure operators, that was the question, because they contribute to a particular limit of the superconformal index, which is called the sure limit. And this is where sure polynomials appear. So it's a bit of a historical detour that led us to call them sure operators. So let me say some words for those people who know Chiral algebras, and at the same time, for those who don't know Chiral algebras, I'll try to explain what the words mean very briefly, just in the case of the free hyper. So let me denote by Q of Z, basically the operator that I get. Qi of Z bar. In the Chiral algebra, that means in the twisted correlators of the sure operators. In other words, in the kind of correlators that I wrote there. So in these kind of correlators, I can basically define this contracted thing as an elementary field. Let me call it Q of Z. And similarly, of course, I can define Q tilde of Z in the same way. Then the fancy words are that we have a Chiral algebra for us at the level at which we are working is basically a set of these meromorphic operators whose correlation functions are completely meromorphic. So that's that's what we have here, a set of meromorphic correlation functions. It is generated by Q of Z and Q tilde of Z. And what I mean by generated is that, in parentheses, that all the operators in the Chiral algebra are either Q tilde or normal ordered versions, normal ordered products. Like, for example, I can define an operator, let me say Q del Q tilde. But in my definition, that is just the limit. It's just a normal order. This is just the limit as W goes to Z of Q of W del Q tilde of Z minus the singular terms in the OPE. So that's what I mean with generated. It doesn't mean that this is the only operator in this set of correlation functions, but it means that all the other operators are just normal ordered products of the generators. And so here there's a small sleight of hands, because now I'm defining creation, or I define normal ordering in the chiral algebra sense, whereas there it was, well, basically four-dimensional normal ordering. But for the free hyper, you can show that it's the same thing. And in a general quantum field theory, I'll just use the chiral algebra normal ordering from now on.
Great, another question. So the word chiral algebra is used by mathematicians in physics.
Yeah, I think it's a proper chiral algebra in the mathematical sense.
This is word which is used in very specific form by the math people.
Yes.
So I'm asking, is it exactly the same?
I believe so, yes. I believe it's the same as... when I say chiral algebra, it's what math people mean for the chiral algebra. Notice, however, that it doesn't have a proper Hilbert space. One interesting... it has a good vector space of states. But here, for example, you see that the norm, the inner product here, is not positive definite.
But you can typically define that this vertex algebras.
That's correct. I just wanted to make that qualification. It's a vertex operator algebra in the proper sense. Yeah.
But just another question. If you start to define formally conformal blocks, etc., what does it mean at the level of field theory? So if you try to apply formalism on that side, which you know very well, there is one-to-one correspondence much more subtle.
I think before you say conformal blocks, maybe you want to ask about the representation theory of this algebra. You want to ask about modules of this algebra, right? And that's a wholly different subject, because at the moment we seem to just have the chiral algebra. We don't have any non-trivial modules. We just have the identity or the vacuum representation, basically.
I'm asking, you know, what, again, this is a general question. What do you expect the correspondence between objects and home?
Yeah, but it depends on which object you ask about. At the level of correlation function, it's obvious that the chiral algebra correlation functions are just twisted versions of 4D correlation functions. At the level of OPE, there is some kind of sense in which the chiral algebra OPE is some twisted version of the four-dimensional OPE. That's all completely fine. At the level of characters, you may want to ask about that. You can show that the graded character of the chiral algebra is equal to a certain limit of the superconformal index in four dimension. At the level of representations of the chiral algebra, non-trivial ones, so operators that are not chiral but transform in representations of the algebra, it's much more subtle, because we don't seem to have a place for them here. And in fact, the only way we can see that these representation non-trivial modules appear is by the insertion of supersymmetric defects at the origin. And those are believed to give rise to modules of the chiral algebra. But I definitely don't have time to talk about the defect story. And so I was not finished with this sentence, so let me finish the sentence here. So a chiral algebra is a set of meromorphic correlation functions, a bunch of operators with meromorphic correlators. It has two generators in this case. And everything else I just get by this kind of normal ordering. And to fully specify the correlation functions, as I said before, all I need to give you is the short distance singularities of the generators. So let me give you those singular OPEs, operator product expansion. So QZ, Q tilde W, we've already seen, is minus 1 over Z minus W. And let me use this tilde symbol, which means up to regular terms, so up to order Z minus W to the 0. QZ, QW is 0, and Q tilde Z, Q tilde W is 0. So when I write 0, it's again up to regular terms. So it's not really 0, it's just regular. There's no short distance singularity. And so this suffices to compute, in principle, all the correlation functions of Q and Q tilde, any number of Qs, any number of Q tildes, because you know all the short distance singularity. And then by doing this normal ordering procedure, so you bring two operators close together, you get some singular terms, you subtract them all, and then whatever is left, you define to be the normal ordered product. In this way, you can generate all the normal ordered, the correlation functions of the normal ordered product of these operators. And so this gives you, in principle, these three equations are now sufficient to for you to compute the entire Chiral algebra. So these fancy words here, Chiral algebra, generators, and singular OPEs, are important words. And I hope that in this simple example, at least, you sort of understand what they mean now. So in fact, this Chiral algebra has a name. It's the Chiral algebra of symplectic bosons with HQ equals HQ tilde of dimension 1/2 in the Chiral algebra. Yeah. So for those who know Chiral algebra so a little bit, this is already a sign that Chiral algebras are not unitary, even though the four-dimensional theory upstairs was perfectly unitary. But the Chiral algebra is not. Okay, any questions? Why it's not unitary? Because it didn't have to be. If a correlation function, a matrix, let's say one particular consequence, a necessary condition for unitarity, is that, for example, the matrix of two-point functions of primary operators is positive definite, because it's some kind of norm. And you can perfectly write some positive definite matrix if you take care of the R symmetry indices and you group it into R symmetry representations and you contract it with the U's, like I did, then suddenly you introduce some minus signs. You get some sign flips, and because you contract the U's with some epsilons, and suddenly you get negative norm states in the Chiral algebra. So that's why it doesn't have to be unitary. I mean, we're working in some complexified algebra here, right? So, okay, I say those words, but let me just maybe come back to that later, because then it's much more easy to see why we complexified things. So this was, in a nutshell, how you generate a Chiral algebra. We did a simple Chiral algebra. But of course, it's much more interesting to ask, what is the Chiral algebra of specific theories? What other information can we learn from this, from these Chiral algebras? What other kind of general structures can we learn about Chiral algebras in 4D theories, and so on and so on? So that's going to be some of that I'll discuss later on. But first of all, I have to explain to you why this is the case, why you would get this chiral structure. So that was the pedestrian approach, and now we'll discuss chiral algebras, the sort of proper approach. Well, the really proper approach, it would be in the theory, in the theory section of our paper, but I'll do it fairly quickly. So that I have some time for other things. So the reason for this chirality is that we work in the cohomology of a supercharge that we are traditionally denoting as funny Q. I guess in our paper it's more like funny Q, which is defined to be Q minus 1 plus S tilde 2 minus dot. And in our conventions, we work in radial quantization. We have that its complex conjugate, or its emission conjugate is this one. So this funny supercharge has the following funny properties. First of all, it's close to zero. So we can indeed consider its cohomology without any issues. The anti-commutator of funny Q with its complex conjugate gives me the dilatation operator, the Lorentz, some Lorentz rotation, and two times R, SE2R symmetry, one of the three SE2R symmetry generators. And this is maybe an object that, or a quantity on the right-hand side that you've seen before, because or you recognize from before. Because remember, I said sure operators have delta equals J1 plus J2 plus J2R. So for sure operators, this thing here on the right-hand side is zero. So this M++, I haven't really given you all my conventions, but this M++ gives you J1, M++ plus dot gives you J2. This is, of course, 2R, and that's just the dilatation operator, gives you the conformal weight. So we deduce from the fact that this thing is the anti-commutator of Q with Q dagger that necessarily, for all states in the theory, in a unitary theory, this thing is on the right-hand side is positive. For all states, for all the operators or states, and that an operator is sure if and only if it is killed by the Qs. So here you already see that this abstract sure condition has some useful, has some kind of natural-ish interpretation from the viewpoint of the representation theory of the superconformal algebra. What else? Well, that's just one, two properties. The third one is that. Okay, now, so this operator, we're going to work in the cohomology of this guy. If I insert a sure operator at the origin, it's Q closed. So that's good. Now let's start moving it. Let's try to move it in the one direction. I find that it's non-zero. So if I just move it out in the one direction, I find that it's no longer Q closed. So because the commutator of funny Q with P1 is non-zero. The commutator with P2 is also non-zero. So I cannot move in those directions. but the commutator with PZ is zero. So we can move this operator, which was sure, we can move it without punishment in the Z direction. Then it'll still be Q closed. So it follows that Q acting on e to the z pz, my sure operator at the origin, is still zero. So what about the z bar direction? If I just try to move it naively in the z bar direction, I find the same as trying to move it as when I tried to move it in the 1 and 2 direction, it's not Q closed. But remember what we have. We have these sure operators with R symmetry indices contracted in some Z bar dependent way. So if I move an operator in the Z bar direction, I also rotate it a little bit. I rotate it a little bit by virtue of these U's in R symmetry space. So the thing I need to look at happens to be the translation in the Z bar direction. Or let me make that explicit. So let me look at the z bar of ui of z bar, oi of z bar. So let's look at this. Well, this is just ui of z bar, oi z So this is just a z bar derivative of the operator OI z z bar. But then, of course, the z bar derivative can also hit the u, and then I just get, in my case, it's O2 of z z bar. So what is this? Well, you can write this as a z bar derivative plus an R symmetry rotation, R minus OI of z. And here we work in the complexified algebra, so this R minus is just a matrix with all with 2x2 matrix with three zeros and one off diagonal element equal to one. So that's why it gives you this that's why it gives you precisely O2 back. And so the operator that we have to look at to see if we want if we stay in the cohomology is not PZ bar, but it's PZ bar plus R minus. And this guy happens to be Q closed, but furthermore, it is actually also Q exact. So it's the Q anti-commutator of some fermionic guy that is not particularly important for us. And so this is why the z-bar dependence drops out. Because, I want to keep this. So I need to lower one of the boards. Some blackboard juggling, sorry. So I've said that the z-bar derivative of these twisted translated Schur operators is Q exact, and so that would give me the chirality of not translated but twisted translated Schur operators. So in the Q cohomology, the z-bar dependence drops out. I think this is all I want to say. Is this clear? If you believe all this fact, is it then clear that chirality follows? I've stated them as facts. There are a lot of things to check that not just the anti-commutator, but also the fact before that I wrote that the Schur operators are always highest weights of all the SU2s and all these things. So I stated a lot of things without fact. You can find a lot more details in our paper. But I hope that the logic is sort of clear. We're in the cohomology of the supercharge. We insert something that's Q-closed. We move it around. And in the z-direction, we're still Q-closed. In the z-bar direction, we're Q-exact. Sorry, what was the second part of the question?
Why is it so that if you move it in the one at the direction, it's non-zero?
You're asking why one, two direction it's non-zero, but the third and fourth direction it's special? Well, that's because I took particular Lorentz indices on my definition of funny Q. There's a minus there and a minus dot. And that specifies a particular two-plane. I can rotate the whole structure, and then the minus there and the minus dot there will be some other direction in spinner space. Then it will not be the X3 four plane, but some other two plane. But none of that is going to affect anything, of course. So this is just a choice of conventions where we get the X3, X4 plane. So there's no other Chiral algebra that you can find. In fact, we did a more comprehensive analysis also. This is sort of the only Chiral algebra structure up to conjugation that you can find in the SC2.2/2 algebra. So we were busy compiling a list of properties of Qs. We had property 1, Q squared equals 0, property 2, this anti-commutator, property 3, holomorphic translations, and 4, anti-holomorphic twisted translations. Then property 5 is going to be that there's, in fact, it's not just the translations that are Q closed in the holomorphic directions. There's an entire SL2Z as a subalgebra of the superconformal algebra is Q closed. So this is an SL2 generated by translations. So this one I already showed you that it's Q closed. But it's also true that the corresponding L1 and L0 are Q-closed, where 2L0 is D plus M plus 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 M plus dot plus dot. And this, in the Chiral algebra, plays the role of my dilatation operator. So in particular, the eigenvalue of 2L0 of L0 gives me the dilatation weight of the twisted translated operator. So from this, I read off that ui z bar oi z bar in the Chiral algebra has weight h equals delta plus j1 plus j2 over 2. So let's check for the free boson. We had symplectic bosons of weight 1/2, and indeed j1 and j2 is 0. For them, delta equals 1, so h equals 1/2. So that's one example. And there's one more thing that I want to say, which is that there is a twisted SL2 hat z bar, where the hat means twisted. Which is Q exact. This guy is generated by E z bar plus r minus l hat 1 equals k z bar minus r plus, and l hat 0 is minus 2 r. So this is Q exact, but I already told you up there that the thing on the right-hand side is Q-exact. So the thing on the right-hand side, the Q-dagger anti-commutator, is in fact the L hat 0 of some twisted SL2 hat algebra, which is a subalgebra of SL2.2/2. And in fact, it's now interesting to see if you can do these twists more generally. And then you realize that the SL2 hat is just a subalgebra, not of the full SL2.2/2, but just of an SL2/2 subalgebra of the full four-dimensional superconformal algebra. And so this means this is the n equals to 4 superconformal algebra in two dimensions. So this implies that Chiral algebras, I'm not sure if Chiral algebras exist at this level, but at this stage, but I can say the same construction. Should work for any superconformal algebra that has an SL2/2 subalgebra. So you don't need this full four-dimensional superconformal algebra. The moment you have an SL2/2, you can define this twisted guy. You can twist the correlation functions, and you get something where some z-bar dependence drops out. So, and then you can go over the list of superconformal algebras, and then you find that this should work in 0,4 theories. In D equals 2, or 2,0 theories, which is maximal, in D equals 6. And so this is just a consequence of the structure of the algebra. The representations and what the sort of analysis of the Schur operators we did already in D equals 6, and we have a nice paper about the Chiral algebras for the maximally supersymmetric theories in 6 dimensions. For 0,4 theories, we have some work in progress, but we don't have a paper on this on these Chiral algebras yet. So these were the sort of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 maybe properties that I wanted to highlight of this operator.
So you said that for 4 n equal 2, this is sort of a unique choice for the Chiral algebra construction.
Yes.
When I say how general did you expose? Did you take consider all the linear combinations of super Chiral algebras? Or did you start from short algebra?
No, so the question is how unique, how do you know that this was really the unique choice of a Chiral algebra in 4D n equals 2 theories? So of course, yeah, you have to make some choices because you, a similar analysis of sort of protected correlation functions should give you all the Chiral rings, for example. Or at least the ones that have lead to non-zero correlation functions. So I think I don't quite remember the details, but I think if you ask for an SL2/SL2, then you're basically and one of them you can twist, then you're basically done. Then you basically find that there's a unique choice. In fact, there's a unique choice, but within that unique choice, there's sort of two funny cues that you can decide, but they give rise to the same cohomology. So.
Well, except that it's not completely obvious to me why you need SL2/2.
Yes, no, you can, I don't know, you can try to compile a list of twists for SL2/2, and I don't think we can claim to have done that. So. Yeah, maybe I should point out the funny property of our funny queue, that it has an S in it. And what people of the cohomology that people have often considered in supersymmetric theories was the cohomology of supercharges, so the cohomology of Qs. Qs commute with translation. So in that cohomology, you generally find things that are position independent. You find correlation functions that are just independent of positions. In our case, we have an S, a conformal supercharge there, in the funny Q, in the operator whose cohomology we consider. And therefore, this guy does not commute with translations. And that's what sort of gives us our more interesting structure. Where there are still some, you're in the cohomology, but there's still some position dependence left.
So, sir, has there been any work in 3 dimensions?
In 3 dimensions, there's a paper by Chris and Wolfgar and Leonardo about how a similar, and also Silvio Puffo and friends, about how a similar construction works if you put operators on a line. And then you get something position independent. So there's no Chiral algebra anymore. I still have a few minutes left. So So I can briefly explain a few of the sure operators. So we can also make contact with this long story of the representation theory that I considered before, that I discussed before. So for example, from the b hat 1 half multiplet, we already saw that q and q tilde are sure. So I'm not going to repeat that story again. I already pointed out to you that from the b hat 1, the superconformal primary mu a ij is sure, because it has delta equals 2, r equals 1, and j1 equals j2 equals r equals 0. Now we have an expression up there for the weight of whatever the twisted translated the operator is going to have in the Chiral algebra. And the weight of this guy is going to be 1. So we get an operator that I'll denote as JA of Z. Remember, this A is an adjoint flavor index. So it's, it has nothing to do with supersymmetry. It's just a flavor thing, which is UI UJ mu A IJ in the Chiral algebra. Or maybe I should change this subscript, because now we know that in the Chiral algebra really means in the Q cohomology. So this is a dimension 1 operator that transforms in the adjoint of some flavor symmetry. And you should maybe you can maybe some of you recognize that this is just this is likely to be the generator of a Kac-Moody symmetry. but for that to happen, it would have to have a singular OPE, which looks like this. Plus regular terms. As it happens, this is true. So you can take the four-dimensional OPE of this guy, which by supersymmetry is related to the four-dimensional OPE of the flavor current with itself. That OPE you know, the OPE of a flavor current with itself in four dimensions has this kind of structure, where there's some well, there's some identity operator, and then there's the thing itself with the flavor symmetry current itself with the same structure constant. Then by supersymmetry, you know this OPE. Then you twist it, and up to Q exact terms, you find precisely this. And there is a connection. So in 4D, let me not write the full OPE because it's a bit messy, but let me just say that the two-point function of currents is something like, do I have the corrections? Maybe up to some factors of pi, but let me swipe that under the rug. X mu over x to the 8. So in four dimensions, the two-point function of currents is characterized by this number here, which is the level or the flavor. Well, we call it the flavor central charge. And it happens to be independent of exactly marginal coupling. It's just a constant that is associated to any 4D n equals 2 theory with flavor. It's some number of flavor central charge. And of course, this is a two-point function, so it must have positive norm. And the four-dimensional flavor central charge is positive. And as it happens, after you sort of take this two-point function of currents by supersymmetry, you relate it to the two-point function of the superconformal primary, you do the twist, you find some extra factors, and you find that k2d is minus k4d over 2. (Clears throat) And by looking at the three-point functions of currents in four dimensions, you can similarly deduce this term in the OP. So the funny part here is that if you have flavor symmetry in four dimensions, then you have a flavor symmetry current. Then by supersymmetry, you have this guy. It's also called the moment map. It's the superconformal primary of the flavor symmetry multiplet. Then that guy I can twist, and this guy gives me the twisted superconformal primary of the flavor symmetry multiplet, gives me a affine Katz-Moody algebra current in the Chiral algebra.
So there's no quantization condition on K2?
No.
Is that okay?
Yes. Well, there's no unitarity here. It's negative already. So there's no... I don't know of any constraints that they would want to impose on K2D.
So in two dimensions, it's this Katz-Moody symmetry is not associated
to any?
Compact.
Yeah, the group is, well, I'm not sure about the group. There's a flavor symmetry algebra, which is this guy transforms in the adjoint of. It's usually associated to a compact group that I agree with. But this flavor central charge here is not necessarily an integer either. And so this guy can also be random. And this is just some affine Katz-Moody extension of the group. In fact,
can I ask you a question? So, for example, this Katz-Moody look at things like the order construction, Virasoro. Does Virasoro have any interpretation in terms of
the... Yes, excellent question. So the question is whether there is a Virasoro, but there's some kind of... Well, the question is if the Sugawara construction, the associated Virasoro algebra, has any four-dimensional interpretation. The answer will be that there is a canonical Virasoro subalgebra of the Chiral algebra, which may or may not be the Sugawara one. And that Virasoro subalgebra comes from the n equals 2 stress tensor. Let me do that now. okay, so the other question will then have to wait a little bit. I wanted to briefly give an answer to that question, but let's... Since I have 5 minutes left, I should make a choice, and let me choose to answer the Virasoro question because it's very important. There we go. So another Schur operator was the stress tensor multiplet. It also contributed a Schur operator, 0, 0, 0. We found that the SU2R symmetry current with delta equals 3, R equals 1, J1 equals J2 equals 1/2 is Schur. And now we can also decide on the computed dimension. It's delta plus J1 plus J2 over 2, which, if I'm not mistaken, is equal to 2. So there you go. We have not from the four-dimensional stress tensor, but from the four-dimensional stress tensor multiplet, we have a dimension 2 operator in the Chiral algebra, which is completely neutral under all of the flavor symmetries. so let's define T of Z to be ui, uj, j, ij plus plus dot in the cohomology. And then we get an OPE where t of 0 is c over 2 z to the 4th plus 2t over z squared plus del t over z, where this two-dimensional central charge is equal to minus 12 times the four-dimensional central charge. And the four-dimensional central charge is defined by the two-point function of the stress tensor multiplet. as, well, basically just the norm of the stress tensor multiplet. So I'm not going to write out all the ways in which you have to construct these indices. There's a unique way to construct all the indices here, consistent with conformal invariance. And in some conventions, the overall coefficient is then C4D. So let's let me state my conventions for a free hyper. The four-dimensional central charge is equal to minus 1/12. Plus 1/12, sorry. Of course, the four-dimensional central charge is positive. So the two-dimensional central charge is negative. So there's your Virasoro algebra. There is a canonical Virasoro algebra. This you, of course, should recognize as generating a Virasoro algebra. And this Virasoro algebra sort of arises canonically from the stress tensor in four dimensions. So if your four-dimensional theory has a stress tensor, and basically every local four-dimensional theory has one, then the Chiral algebra has a Virasoro stress tensor. Well, it has this Virasoro subalgebra. It takes a little bit of work now to show that this is really the stress tensor of the Chiral algebra, in the sense that its OPE with primaries is also of the correct form. We believe that to be the case, but we don't have complete evidence of this, because it would amount to analyzing upstairs in the four-dimensional theory the OPE of the SC2R symmetry current with all of the Schur operators, and see that certain terms that are forbidden, if this were the proper stress tensor, would not appear. And that was a bit of work, and it seems a bit, we weren't able to show this conclusively. But we strongly believe that this is really, I can really say that this is the stress tensor of the Chiral algebra.
This Gamma system has many, by the way, Virasoro algebra.
Yes, so when I say that this is the stress tensor, I mean that the OPE with a particular primary is of the form so that it generates conformal transformations, right? So in particular, there's no, I think, triple pole in this thing. I don't know, there's no...
No, I think the correlation should be the gamma is fixed, but I can write two different stress tensor and collect different weights. This will be different safety.
Ah.
There is not unique action of Virasoro beta gamma system.
Yes, but then I want to say that there is that...
What you are saying is that there is one particular Virasoro which comes from 4D.
In some sense. There's this 4D, there's those 4D generators, they descend to SL2Z. And so is this SL2Z, when it acts on the local operators in the Chiral algebra, generated by this stress tensor or not? That is a question. And our claim is that it is, but it's not trivial. And indeed, there's, for example, for the Kac-Moody algebra here, you can define also a dimension 2 operator. So in my last 30 seconds, let's look at JA of Z, JA of 0. Let's look at JA, JA, normal ordered, in the Chiral algebra. This is also a dimension 2 operator, and it's also neutral under flavor symmetry because I contracted the indices. So you can ask, what is the difference between this guy and this guy? And as it happens, sometimes they are identical, so their differences are null states. Sometimes this guy is an admixture of the stress tensor and some genuinely new operator which came from something different upstairs. So it's sometimes hard to decide what this guy sort of corresponds to in the four-dimensional theory. And after Zohar's lecture, in the end of the of my lecture this afternoon, I'll consider this example in more detail. We'll try to figure out where this can come from in four dimensions. And then we'll see that it's often some admixture of the stress tensor and another multiplet. And the fact that the other guy must have positive norm in four dimensions will give us constraints on these four-dimensional central charges and four-dimensional flavor central charge which just follow from unitarity in this Chiral algebra construction. So in this way, I'll show that the Chiral algebra can give you some very general consistency conditions on these numbers, like the flavor central charge and the central charge, which just follow from this entire construction. So I think I should stop here. Thank you.